Good morning. I want to thank you all for braving the snow and coming over to our program. I know the fact that we're offering ethical credit doesn't mean anything to any of you. So happy you're all here. We're starting with Preamble 9 of the model rules. We're all lawyers. We want to be ethical. We need to be zealous advocates. We need to get along with the judges. We need to be able to go home and lead comfortable, happy lives. And it's really hard to get all those things accomplished at once. And so we've got four professionals, two judges and two other professionals who are zealous in their own way, and they're very passionate about helping all of us do our jobs as well as we can and make our system function well. And again, we're focused on in this circuit on the administration of justice and the administration of our system as best as we can. So we have here, first off, the Honorable B. Lynn Windmill, who is the Chief District Judge for the District of Idaho. The district only has two authorized judgeships, and the court is understaffed. They need to work efficiently, and they need lawyers to cooperate fully. They demand the cooperation of the lawyers. Judge Windmill is excited to take advantage of the opportunities that the 2015 amendments to the federal rules provide to let him preach the gospel to lawyers and judges about the importance of honoring Rule 1's edict to provide just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of all disputes. And he'll share some of his court's best practices today. We then have the Honorable Maureen Tai. Judge Tai is a bankruptcy judge in the Central District of California and is currently the chair of the Ninth Circuit Pro Se Committee. She's also a student of powerful non-defensive communication and is excited to see that the new rules reject the old sabotage, hide the ball, the models that have predominated our practice. And she will describe key elements of PNDC and explain how we can all benefit from incorporating PNDC tools into our practices and our lives. Next, we have Mark Bassingthwaite. He is a lawyer who is with ALPS. He's devoted his entire career to helping lawyers stay out of trouble on the malpractice side and to just generally become better practitioners. And he's going to offer some important tips during our conversation today. And finally, I have Professor Miles V. Link. He is a professor of law at Arizona State University and teaches legal ethics, among other things. He welcomes the opportunity to debunk the common perception that ethical lawyering is inconsistent with zealous advocacy in our adversarial litigation system. So we are going to start with our first question, which is directed to Judge Windmill to start, which is that Rule 1, the amendments, and Justice Roberts' end-of-year statement, which is in your materials, I don't know if you've had an opportunity to see it, indicate that judges and lawyers are all supposed to work together to achieve prompt and efficient resolution of disputes. For some people, this seems like a setup. I mean, your client wants you to be a zealous advocate, and they can be upset when you take a collaborative or collegial approach with the other lawyers and the court. And they may want you to slow things down, not speed them up. The court wants to manage the docket. They want to get things moving. They want that case to get resolved. And sometimes the court's perception of how much time you need doesn't really comport with how much time you think you need. And then two, you don't really, as a lawyer, want someone else telling you how to do your job. I mean, you want to serve your client, but you want to exercise your best judgment and run your case. Judge Windmill, how do we reconcile these pressures?
Well, I think we have to all realize we're in this game together. And I think that's really kind of the beginning point. When the amendments in December of 2015, which changed the stress from the court's responsibility to administer and apply the rules to achieve the just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of all disputes, has now been changed to make clear that it's now the attorney's obligation as well. And I love that emphasis because I think it drives home the point that we are in it together, we have a joint obligation. We are facing difficult times with the rise of ESI, the cost of litigation skyrocketing, litigation and trials are actually plummeting. I think civil litigation, at least in my court, probably 1, maybe 2% of all civil cases are actually tried. I think what has happened is we, as a bench and bar, are pricing ourselves out of the dispute resolution market. And I think we all need to recognize that. We all need to recognize that the need for cooperation is absolutely critical. And so, at least in the District of Idaho, and I think throughout the Ninth Circuit, there's going to be an embracing of these notions of proportionality as a way of trying to reduce cost of litigation, of the obligation to, again, make real. You know, it's rule one for a reason. You know, it's just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of all disputes. And when that modification was made, and Chief Justice Roberts made that kind of the centerpiece of his year-end address to the courts, I was thrilled, because we've been preaching that. In fact, I don't think I've had a Rule 16 scheduling conference without mentioning Rule 1 in 15 years. We talk about it at every turn, about what can we do to reduce cost in litigation. And I don't want to take up all the time, but at some point, I'll want to go through maybe some of the specifics that we've actually done within the District of Idaho. But I don't think it should be, we should all view this as, you know, maybe it's almost like mutually assured destruction, if, you know, the way we avoided nuclear holocaust. As judges and lawyers, that's almost the way we need to approach litigation, is with the idea of trying to make our profession better and make, frankly, our clients' interest truly to the forefront and most important thing that we do. So,
well, I think, Judge Tai, you've got some very specific tools to help us do this.
Well, let me just step back a minute, Kimberly, and put this in context, though, before we get into any specifics. Is what I'm really, those of you who practice in front of me know that I'm just not into the rules. I want to get to the heart of the matter right away, and I'm not one of those people who gets real excited about the niceties of subsections of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. It's just, that's a necessary thing. We need it. But when I read and listened to some of the programs on the new rules, and especially reading Chief Justice Roberts' year-end report, we have had such a shift in the profession, and we need to embrace it, and especially the group here, you know, leading members of the profession, the judges, we need to go out and say, look it, we are no longer in the war model of litigation. Chief Justice Roberts talks about it took until the 1850s to recognize that dueling wasn't the way we're going to resolve disputes. I mean, actual violence, until not that long ago, was how we took care of disputes in this country. And then the courts were a system that was supposed to work, and the federal courts resolve disputes, and we have all sorts of wonderful rules, but they're still modeled on combat. We just do it with words. And now, if you look at all the studies, it was 5 years of studies behind these revised rules, we're into a new set of discovery rules, of ways to approach the vast majority of litigation that happens. As Judge Windmill said, only like 2% of the cases go to trial. So this is most cases. These are the rules, and this is the discovery procedures that control. We have to move it out of the war model and just communicate. It's really simple. And one of the theories that I think has really helped me in communicating more appropriately in court and getting us out of the war model is using Sharon Ellison's training on powerful non-defensive communication. It's in your materials. It's too hard to get into a really long description of it in the short time we have, but one of the key concepts is actually asking questions, neutral, inquisitive questions intended to gather information. And that's really what the discovery rules are. It's what Judge Windmill's talking about. Get out and ask, what do you need? What is that? With truly a desire to learn. Because when you learn about each other's case, when you actually have all the facts, you're more likely to reach resolution more quickly instead of all the motion practice and 18 emails back and forth in the fights. And so my whole approach is, how do we get to that sooner and share information on both sides? Because that's when we can start moving to resolution. So that's the underlying concept behind whatever we do.
And one of the things that that strikes me, and one of the interests I have in this subject, is the consistency and finding the consistency between the ethics rules and the civil rules. And in addition to teaching at Arizona State University, I also chair the ABA Standing Committee on Ethics and Professional Responsibility. And the evolution of the ethics rules over the past decade has been quite interesting, and some of you may be familiar with Ethics 2000 process and the Ethics 2020 process, and the effort to try to make the rules consistent and so that they can address current issues. One rule, 1.13, the dealing with organizational representation, for example, was intended to be made consistent with the Securities Exchange Commission rules regarding lawyer responsibility. In the context that Judge Windmill discussed, the just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of trials, Remember, Rule 3.2 specifically says that it is an ethical duty to expedite litigation consistent with the interests of the client. And some lawyers say, consistent with the interests of the client provides an opportunity to avoid expediting litigation because delay is in our interest. And the rulemakers were very aware of that possible interpretation. And so they said in the comment, I think it's comment one to the rule, that no, if you're going to interpose delay in the trial or in the pretrial discovery, it's got to be for a purpose other than delay. That there's got to be a substantive, and the rule comment specifically says there's got to be a substantive reason. Witnesses are not available for depositions. Information is still being gathered before interrogatories can be answered. There's got to be a real substantive reason because, in fact, systemically, and as Judge Windmill said, we are all in this together. Systemically, the system has got to show the public that it is addressing the need for just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of disputes. And the ethics rules are very aware of that and are, we'll talk about some other consistencies, but that's one area where, in fact, the two sort of systems, the procedure and ethics, actually mutually reinforce each other.
Which gets me to a very practical position. I mean, what I do is I'm dealing with the day-to-day realities in law practices. And I start to think about, you know, I start to ask some questions and think about practicalities. How do we move in this direction? And I want to question assumptions and make sure that we're not running with assumptions. And one of the questions that I start to ask initially is, whose case is it? You know, so many lawyers are very good at lawyering the case, making all the decisions. This is how we've always done it. This is how you don't immediately respond to discovery requests. Stop. I mean, lawyers can get sued. Now, I'm not saying it's a viable claim all the way to the end, but for just not managing the relationship. So I think there's value in sitting down and having some discussions with our clients. You were talking about inviting them to some of the meetings. I think that's a great idea because it allows people to meaningfully participate in their representation. I mean, we all know that one of the most common disciplinary complaints, my lawyer never talks to me. It's in every state. That's one or two. It seems to me there's value now to start to think about that. And in the context of these rule changes, look at that and explore. Okay, we need a shift.
You know, Mark, that's so accurate. And in the context of the rule changes, note how Rule 26 is now promotes even more discourse between counsel. And obviously Rule 16, the pretrial conference, they are promoting more discourse. And this ties in with Judge Teague's comment about the need for non-defensive communication, positive and proactive communication. And you are so right. Statistically, the most, which is not intuitively correct because you think lawyers know how to talk to people and would talk to their clients, but statistically, the most common complaint clients have against their lawyers is failure to communicate. The second is their fees are too high, but let's not go there. But the most common is failure to communicate.
Could I add just one additional comment? I think what is really the genius of this amendment to Rule 1 is the recognition that we cannot really achieve just, speedy, or inexpensive resolution of disputes unless we're acting in a cooperative fashion.
Yes.
I don't think judges can dictate that upon attorneys. Successfully. It has to have buy-in. And I made the comment earlier as we were discussing that I feel to some extent getting clients involved in that initial Rule 16 conference, or at least allowing a representative to be on the phone if it's done telephonically, so that it gives the attorneys cover so that they know the judges are on board and they can see the cooperative effort where the judges and the lawyers are actually trying to be creative in coming up with ways to reduce cost and delay. And, you know, I think talk about getting goodwill with your client. If they recognize and can participate in a conference where they're talking with a federal judge and all the attorneys about ways to reduce cost and expense, I think it helps the entire profession in some really substantial and meaningful ways.
Judge?
I think some of the litigators out there are probably saying, oh, that just really wonderful. You know, let's all sing kumbaya and cooperate. And you've got a client that's expecting you to be the hired gun. Or you have a major discovery bully on the other side that's just going to try scorched earth. But I think these techniques, if you can really embrace them, stop that kind of behavior. If you bring the client in, the client gets to understand what the expectations are. I mean, explain Rule 26A1. Say, look, if you want to bring this suit or if we're going to defend this, this is what we have to turn over. And those are the rules. And you can get sanctioned. I can get sanctioned if we don't turn it over. Communicate with the client right off. And if you've got one of these bullies, you've got these early status conferences with a judge where they can see, no, we have to cooperate. You can make it clear that the new regime is communication and cooperation. I mean, every time we revise these rules, it's to shut down the scorched earth tactics. That as long as the courts are going to be these ways where we can just run up costs, people are not going to resolve disputes through our courts. It's just too expensive. So I think it really works to our advantage to embrace the new approach.
Judge Windmill, you've got some specific procedures that you've developed in Idaho that you think are going to help.
Yeah, I'll try to cover them quickly. One is the rule, and I see Bob Bryan from the Western District of Washington, who probably taught me everything I know about case management, so I feel real sheepish here even saying this. But this is all an expression, I think, of his intent and what he taught me probably 15 years ago. But in any event, these are the things that I've taken from the new rules. One is an aggressive but also a cooperative Rule 16 conference very early, absolutely requiring a meaningful discovery plan, but also expressing to the attorney the fact that the judges will be cooperative. It is very difficult, I think, particularly for defense counsel, who may have a case 2 weeks before the first Rule 16 conference, to really be able to engage in a meaningful discovery plan or a conference to develop a plan. So what we've tried to do is explain to the attorneys, we're now scheduling interim status conferences in every case every 3 months, and in complex cases sometimes once a month. And the idea is to start off with a discovery plan, but realize that once you get into the case, things are going to change. But the overriding principle will not change, that the court and the lawyers will work together to constantly be looking at ways to streamline and reduce cost. And as long as we have that as kind of our mantra, then these conferences will be ways that we can make that all happen. We have a target of reducing the time for discovery by about 3 months in all categories of cases. The interim status conferences, when we get close to the end of the dispositive motion deadline, one topic of those interim conferences will be to discourage a summary judgment motion unless it's really necessary, because I think far too many motions are filed, the expenses incurred, the delay results on a case where there is disputed issues of fact all over the place. Another major factor, but one we've been doing for a long time, is discovery mediation. I virtually never hear a discovery dispute. We have a process in which the attorneys are required to submit a written statement. And what one thing we found is when the attorneys are required to sit down and write out what their objection is and then submit it to the court, realizing they're going to actually be talking to a judge or perhaps to an experienced law clerk, somehow when they put it in writing, their argument just kind of crumbles, and we see a lot of those just go away. But virtually 90% of our cases get resolved through mediation. If we can't resolve the discovery dispute through mediation, then we give them 3 days to file a 5-page mini brief, and we'll issue a decision within 48 hours after that. So there, and part of the reason we do that is to make sure that the attorneys understand that we're not only talking the talk, you know, we're walking the walk. We will have a decision out within 48 hours, except on weekends, so that cases will not get hung up because of discovery disputes. And I think that's probably the high points of what we're trying to do. And we've seen some remarkable success. I had a case just a week ago in which the attorneys came in initially and wanted 12 months to do discovery on a pretty straightforward case. I said I couldn't see a reason in the world why they needed more than 9 months. But I said, okay, let's set it at 9 months, and then you can come back and plead in an interim status conference for some more time. They came back to the interim status conference about 45 days later and said, Judge, we took a hard look at this. We think we can have discovery done in 6 months, which beat even my projection. So I think attorneys are starting to embrace this. They realize it is in their best interest. And I told the attorneys that tears were coming down my eyes as I saw how well they had embraced this concept. So.
I agree with Judge Windmill on all of these approaches. I think we use most of them as well, just maybe call them something different. The one thing that I feel strongly about as a judge is to ask a lot of questions early on at the initial status conference. If somebody tells me I need, you know, 12 months in discovery, I think my earlier instinct would have been to say, why in the world do you need 12 months? I'll give you 9, as opposed to saying, why do you need 12 months? And if they explain it, but often they can't explain it, they're just protecting themselves because they just got the file a week ago. And I find it's more effective to say, well, why don't we do an initial phase of discovery and come back in 2-3 months or however long it's going to take for the initial phase and see if how long we need then. Because by then, the lawyers can get in depth in the case. You know, you've all been stuck with showing up on a case and you don't know anything about it at that point. So I'm torn between having too many conferences and the time it takes and the way it runs up costs and doing things on a staged basis. And I find most people need just certain basic information, and then they can move the case and they can resolve it. You're all good in judging a case, and you can settle it. But the key is really not for the judge not to hijack the case from the attorney, to ask truly open questions and be inquisitive. And that's hard to do because we're all trained to think we know it all at this point. And you know, this case sounds like another case, and this is how you can resolve it. But if you can ask open questions and really not have an agenda, both with opposing counsel and as a judge, it's sometimes surprising some of the information you get. Like, oh, okay, now I understand why you're saying that.
Can I also add into that, though, in terms of, I think about effective communication and all the things, you know, asking lots of questions and educating clients, you know, all of this is very, very important. But there's another piece. Make sure that you take the time to listen and hear what the other side is saying, or to hear what the client is truly wanting and the reasons why, to hear what the judge, we need to listen, and or we're just going to be spinning gears here for
nothing. I think that I totally agree with that. I would add, often when lawyers, before they have the conference with the judge, whether the lawyers alone or with their clients, the lawyers have to communicate with their clients about the litigation process. And again, the ethics rule 1.2a sort of gives lawyers some guidance. It's the client who determines the scope of the representation. I retained you to we're trying to enforce a contract, we're trying to do something else. But it's the lawyer who has to determine in consultation with the client, but it is the lawyer's expertise that determines how that goal is to be met. And one of the things non-lawyer clients need to understand is that engagement in the process involves the need to comply with various rules and obligations and requirements, such as the civil rules, such as discovery, and that's part of the process. And so you've retained me, and it is my expertise that you're asking for, that you're looking for, that will help achieve the goal that you have set. And it's that relationship. The client can say this is the scope of the representation, but it's the lawyer who determines how those goals are met. You advise the client what you're saying and why you're saying it, but ultimately the lawyer has to let the client know that's exactly the reason I've been retained in this representation.
To underscore, again, getting back to this, this can be all very, you know, kumbaya kind of stuff. Let me give you a risk manager's perspective on some of this. You know, it gets back to, you know, whose case is it, you know, those kinds of things. But some lawyers are going to say, okay, this is all feel-good stuff, but, you know, we can make a lot of money, and the scorched earth is the way, that's what the client wants, and all these kinds of things. Okay, you know how we look at that in terms of the malpractice side? I mean, I work with the carrier. I work for the malpractice company. When you have a client that it's the point, it's you know, the principle of the thing, money be damned, and that's just, you know, play hardball, you're seeing exactly how they are going to treat the lawyer going after you later on when they get the bill for $700,000. Are you kidding me? I had no idea. I didn't get the result I wanted. You did not tell me the legal ramifications, the financial ramifications of all this stuff. What do you mean sanctions? Do you see? So again, there are very good, even just risk management reasons why I embrace everything I'm hearing here. And I just encourage you to move in this direction.
There's a list of kind of some good statements to use, and about page 164 of the materials out of the powerful non-defensive communications training. And one of them I think is really effective, both with clients and then in court where you have somebody as a judge. It's making statements as opposed to just letting this all escalate and you sharing your opinion. And you say, I hear you saying you want me to go to town, get every document, scorched earth litigation. But I see you only want to spend $50,000 on this litigation. I conclude that you're not being realistic or fully understand what litigation is about. So I need to explain a few things to you. And you need to just step by step walk a client through it. Or the judge, where I see what I call the surrender sabotage discovery move. I'm so cooperative. Of course, let's be responsive. These are the rules. And everything's so wonderful. And then the discovery requests come back with nothing answered. Privilege invoked all over the place. It has no basis whatsoever. Complete scorched earth. Let's see if we can make them bring the motion to compel. And then we stand in front of the judge, don't offer any alternatives for how we really could resolve this discovery dispute. Act as though you've been cooperating. Once you've asked enough questions and really ascertained who's being the scorched earth litigator, say, hear you saying you're cooperative, but I see you've done A, B, C, and D. And then talk about what you conclude, and then you've got to predict what the consequences are. And there, I think it's important to say, if you can proceed this way in the discovery and answer questions 14, 15, and 16, which are not objectionable, we can get on with the case. If you cannot do that by that date, there will be these sanctions. And that's the only way you can keep it going. You let the your client or the other side know exactly what you're seeing, and then state exactly what the consequences are and enforce them. Too many times, I think lawyers come in, and the other side whines or comes up with a really weak excuse, and there's not enough time to inquire to what really happened because it's just scorched earth, pox on both your houses. Because I don't want to sort out a discovery dispute, whereas you really have to sort it out and find out, what really happened and have consequences. It's the only way you can stop this kind of litigation. And so you've got to explain that to your client, and you have to explain it to the other side if it gets that far to be in court.
I think external circumstances have almost forced attorneys to this, and I don't think we're getting the pushback from attorneys that we might have gotten 20 years ago. I think ESI, scorched earth litigation tactics 20 years ago is something quite different from what it is today with ESI and dealing with terabytes of data that and I think so that we should take that into account in our discussion as well, that every attorney, if you've been involved in any cases that have that level of complexity, would have to know how absolutely impossible it would be to cope with that kind of data without at least some cooperation in terms of search terms and means of production. It almost requires, if you want to survive, cooperation. And I think that hopefully will make it a little easier as we as judges and lawyers try to work together.
Part of the challenge is, as a lawyer, maybe I think that I probably can get by with only 5 documents, and as a bankruptcy lawyer, there are lots of times when I make do with whatever I've got. But particularly if I'm in district court, I want to be sure that I haven't missed anything. I don't want to leave any stone unturned, and I don't want my client turning on me because I'm out there to do a good job, but I might have left a stone unturned. At the same time, with the discussions about proportionality, and particularly proportionality, I think, how do I balance that ethically and practically?
Well, I think on the proportionality issue, you have an obligation to your client under 1.3 to proceed with reasonable diligence and promptness. And the comment invokes the term, although not exactly zealous advocacy, but it says you have an obligation to be a zealous advocate for your client. And so, but you implement that requirement or that ethical obligation, again, within the context of the judicial process, within the context of the judicial proceeding. The overarching theme of the rules, repeated in the preamble and scope and in many rules, is that the lawyer has to comply with applicable law, court orders, regulations, etc. And so you cannot engage in conduct that would ultimately disadvantage your client because it's it is outside the scope of due process within the context of this proceeding. And so as you balance the client's needs with the client's demands, with the client's capability or the client's resources, that exactly is the kind of judgment the lawyer has to make. How do I mesh what the client can afford, what the scope is of what the client is trying to achieve, with against the resources and the legal arguments of the other side, which may be substantial and have great merit, to try to reach a result that is satisfactory to the client. And often, and again, as we all know, in the process, the client's goals may change as the client realizes, you know what, in order to achieve what I want, it would cost far more than it's worth and far more than I have, or B, I cannot achieve the goal I thought I could achieve in light of what I now understand the law and the facts to be. And so part of that education is exact, and part of that balancing and meshing and judgment is part of what the lawyer has to exercise, and the rules acknowledge that, and 1.3 makes that clear.
Let me talk about a practical side of this. It's a fascinating issue, and honestly a very high-risk issue as I see it. You know, there are lots of articles written and CLEs done on limited scope representation. We're always talking about it, you know, when we decide to limit our scope, what do? But what we're really kind of playing with here is client-driven limitations on our scope. And that is where lawyers really step into some traps at times. A reality is there are going to be conversations, at least I would hope that this is occurring, about, you know, what does the budget look like here? You know, how much are we going to spend and how much are we going to throw at this? And how do we do it efficiently? Because if a client is not fully aware of what the costs are and what we get for it, you've got problems down the road. Why didn't you tell me? You know, so it's quite common that you're going to have limitations placed on discovery. I encourage you to have a discussion about it. If it is beyond what you would consider reasonable, I would strongly encourage you to say, I would encourage you to rethink this. But you need to document. You gave the client the advice, what the legal ramifications of the advice that they are not going to follow are, you know, how this could play negatively for them, what are the consequences, why they are choosing not to spend all the money. You see where I start to go? It is very, very important to document all this because in my world, whether it's discipline or malpractice, a reality is if there's not a file with some notes or an email or something that you can point to, the discussion didn't occur.
Mark just introduced a phrase which is very important, limited scope representation. That is a very important issue lawyers need to grapple with because it can be a trap for the unwary. If your client wants you to limit the scope, it's got to be very clear, both to the client and the lawyer, what the limitation is, what the scope of the representation is. The Standing Committee on Ethics has recently issued an advisory ethics opinion on limited scope representation, which I urge you to take a look at, which looks at a number of the very difficult ethical issues involved. Now, again, in order to address the expense of litigation, many clients will want to limit the scope of the representation, but as Mark indicated, it's very important if that's what you're, if that's the situation that presents itself, that you and the client are on exactly the same page as to what the more narrowly defined scope is, and I refer you to that ethics opinion.
Let me jump in and maybe suggest how the courts may play a rather critical role in this, and that is, in fact, I think you have in your materials sort of a cover sheet we send out with our litigation plan and our discovery plan, and that really spells out our commitment to limiting discovery, to proportional discovery, to Rule 1, And when I talk about bringing the attorneys in, I'm doing it not just because I want the case to work smoothly, not just because I want to control the case. I'm not a control freak in any way. But a part of that is to give the attorneys cover. It gives the attorneys an opportunity to explain to a client, not only does Rule 1 require us and Rule 26 and its proportionality standard, but the court has said, we are going to limit discovery, we're going to require a discovery plan, and that's going to lay out what discovery we do and what discovery we don't do. It will have to be in some way approved by the court. And that's also why I suggested that it may be wise at least the initial Rule 16 conference to invite your clients to listen in. And I think those are the kinds of things that I think can give attorneys cover when they're wrestling with this problem. With I remember vividly when I woke up 2 years and one day after I was appointed to judge and realized the statute of limitations had just run on any legal malpractice I've committed. At least I thought that was the case. I don't think any lawyer ever sleeps really well at night because no matter how careful you are, there's always a mistake you can make. And the idea being that if there's one stone you didn't turn over, well, if you didn't turn it over because the judge said, no, we're not going there, it's not proportional, that to me could become very powerful, and in a medical or legal malpractice case might be exhibit one to say this is what the judge said we could or could not do. So that's why I think judges can play a very critical and cooperative role with the attorneys.
Couldn't agree more.
So, okay.
There's a question out here.
I just wanted to follow up. Do you have success with having clients participate with their attorney?
We have not done that. We've just been, this is all a work in progress as of December 2015. Now, I'm not saying that I want a client there who's going to participate vocally, but to listen in. And again, 95% of our Rule 16 conferences are done telephonically because Idaho is a huge state. And we rarely do them in person. I'd rather do them in person, but it's just not practical. But to have a client just listening in and see what is going on in that Rule 16 conference, I think could be a very positive thing.
Let me just answer that one question, then we'll get over there. I actually have had success there, and I think it's important to bring clients sometimes to hear what's going on where you have a client that has unrealistic view. Right. So much of the world's view of litigation is from TV. And we've got, Judge Judy screaming at people, sit down and shut up. And then we have all the drama reduced to a 20-minute segment and resolved in that time. And they really need to get a good understanding of what dispute resolution really is about. And I will sometimes, especially if I have a lawyer from out of the area who's been appearing by phone and clearly not participating, not communicating, not returning calls, not engaging, order them to appear in person. That usually gets some conversation going. And if you have an opponent like that, you might somehow indicate that to the judge, that you need to somehow have a personal conversation, because meeting up in the hallway is the best way to actually resolve a discovery dispute or the whole case. But the client showing up, and sometimes the client just needs to be heard, either talking to the lawyer is not good enough, or they're so worked up about the case. And I've even had, I think, Jonathan, you might have done, sometimes a lawyer will say, would you mind if my client just says a few things? And your first reaction is, he's going to say something privileged. I shouldn't let him talk. This is going to go on forever. I've got a full courtroom. But sometimes that 5 minutes of just the client getting to say what's on his mind or getting to express that anger will just change the tone of the whole case. And you have to really just feel that and judge whether or not, what you know of the case, whether that's a safe situation for you. I think it's really important to keep the clients involved. So much, it goes back to what Mark said, it's the lawyer's case. Well, it's the client's case, and you need to bring him in. And I think most judges can pick up, especially if it's counsel they're familiar with, that let's just let the client talk, or let's find out and ask some questions and make sure you convey they've really been heard. Because then they might be willing to talk about some of the other aspects of the case because they've gotten it off their chest.
I love it because they literally have had their day in court.
Yeah.
Literally.
They might not have to have a whole trial.
We have another question.
Oh. Yeah, my name is Steve McNamee. I'm a senior United States District Court judge in Arizona. And for 26 years, I've had the clients either come to court and or appear by phone. And when I first started that, that was not the model. And we got a lot of pushback from the attorneys. After that, after about a year, the attorneys came back to me and said that was the best thing that ever happened to them because it reduced the expectation of their clients, It was a matter of inconvenience, which litigation is. It's not a convenient thing to come to court, and they're required to do so. And when the attorneys say, oh, judge, I forgot to have my client come there, it's big, bold letters, they have to be there. I told them, I said, okay, their client's here, but yours are not. You can have the choice of I can sanction you under Rule 37, which I don't want to do, or take about $50 out of your pocket and pay for their lunch and their time in court. And they always do that. But the other thing that I do that I think has been very helpful on the Rule 16s, I make the attorneys on both sides put down what is it that you have to prove in order to recover. Yes. And those are the questions that you get to in court when I ask the attorney, how are you going to prove that? And when you get this blank stare, I know that they're going to engage in scorched earth litigation because they're not focusing on what they have to prove. It's what can they do to obstruct the process, and that's not right. So those are some tips we've tried. Not all my colleagues follow that, I will tell you, but it worked for me for 26 years.
I would just add what I didn't learn from Bob Bryan, I learned from Steve McNamee. So
we have one more.
Kim, I just throw out the question for you. Whether or not the entire medium we're in here regarding mediation and these sorts of things has an inherent bias toward defense. And I throw that out because I'll just give two examples. We go through many. But there are a number of states in our union who are in a race to the bottom to obfuscate companies. Wyoming comes to mind. Delaware's running a close second. But I could give others. Obfuscation is a multi-million dollar business, and the Panama Papers aren't an exception. They are something that people pay a ton of money to hide things in this country. So is the plaintiff being unreasonable when they asked for a significant litigation or discovery on that? The second thing is regarding the contingent fee model. Plaintiffs in contingent fee cases aren't using risk managers. You're giving me a model that is a company model, it is a carrier model, and it is not the things that plaintiffs have to deal with. And I would suggest that, you know, we're not going to take the confrontation out of the confrontation clause. There's a certain level of resistance built into this, into the model of litigation. There are real disputes. And I would throw out to you, every time we talk about we're going to make peace and we're going to do that, ask yourself whether or not how many plaintiffs' lawyers, and I come from a defense firm, by the way, folks, a very big defense firm, but my learned opposition, I think, might have a different view of the world.
You know, I'm glad you asked that question because I was waiting for it to come up. We talk about being cooperative, a just, speedy resolution, and changing the tone of how we do litigation. And we think, okay, let's all just sing kumbaya. That's not what we're talking about. These are real disputes with real stakes on both sides and a real need to get to the bottom of things for your client. And there's litigation for a reason. We're not there having a love fest. There's no doubt about it. I'm talking about the communication between people pre-trial. I'm not talking about trial techniques here. That's all laid out. The rules are there. The confrontation clause is honored. This is how we ask questions to gather the information the rules require us to gather. Instead of saying, I can't believe you think 50 questions is appropriate, we can say, do you need all 50 questions answered at this time? Or can we proceed on these 10 questions and then have another meeting? It's a matter of let's get there more quickly. Let's reduce the stress level. I mean, that's one of the biggest complaints of lawyers, and I think judges too, is, you know, all this fighting that's unnecessary. It's a matter of how we draw the line, how we ask questions. You can still have that high-stakes litigation going after somebody hiding it all in the Panama Papers. You can still ask the questions. It's how we approach it and communicate with each other and our clients as we proceed down that path.
I served for 6 years on the Civil Rules Advisory Committee, and I served from 1998 to 2006 when the electronic discovery rules were implemented and a number of other rules, which many people thought were pro-defendant, were for pro-defense bar, were adopted. And subsequently, people think that the amendments to the rules have been pro-defense as opposed to plaintiff. And when you go back to 1968, which was a very active year in the civil rules, practicing or on the committee or teaching then, but then the rules were amended to expand the scope of discovery, to open up Rule 26, Rule 23, and class actions were opened up and expanded, and many people thought that the rules and the system became pro-plaintiff, and that the system was being used to, in a sense, blackmail defendants into settling green mail because the cost of litigation was just too high. So I don't know that I'm so worried about the change that's taken place. I think the goal has been to reach an appropriate middle ground, because the expense of litigation had grown so exorbitant that other forms of dispute resolution and using non-lawyers to resolve legal disputes became attractive alternatives. And so I think the system is looking for a way to make sure that the legal professionals and this edifice of informed legal judgment interpreting our laws is still available to plaintiffs as well as defendants, so that both parties can be a part of the system and neither is either denied their day in court for plaintiffs or risk bankruptcy or risk undue expense for defendants. So that is a delicate balance, but I think the rules, both the pretrial discovery and civil rules and the trial process itself, are attempting to achieve that goal. And I applaud Chief Justice Roberts for focusing us on what that goal is, the just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of these disputes.
I was going to add, I was really glad that comment was made, because I think as soon as the new amendments came out, that was the immediate response, was this is really loaded for the defense bar, and it's going to make the plaintiff's job that much more difficult. My response is that the rules challenge is to treat every case as a unique set of circumstances. And while I totally agree, there are those cases where I think attorneys and perhaps entities, companies, are taking advantage of opportunities for obfuscation, I think, at least on my docket, that's a pretty small band of cases. I think my biggest cases are cases in which money are not even involved, environmental disputes, in which it's really hard-fought litigation over the impact of the sage-grouse or impact of grazing on sage-grouse, things of that sort. And of course, you know, Rule 26 and the proportionality standard refers not just to how much cost is going to be involved, what the money might be, or what money might be recovered at the end of the day, but also how important are the public issues. So it really gives us a chance, I think, what, 7 or 8 standards were to use to apply in the proportionality, to really take a hard look at those issues. Now, another thing that I found happening more and more often is my willingness to impose sanctions. And if I feel, and I think generally, I have a pretty good sense of maybe my antenna starts quivering when I think there's some obfuscation going on, I don't have any qualms about bringing down the hammer and somebody's going to pay, if in fact that's what's going on. I'm pretty confident that our judiciary is going to stand up, and if those are the cases we're facing, they'll take the appropriate steps. I don't know that our system is perfect, but we're all certainly trying to make it perfect and balanced and completely level as a playing field for plaintiffs and defendants alike. So I totally understand that concern, and I hope that we as judges and as lawyers can work together to not let that become kind of the force that moves litigation.
I want to move the direction just a little bit. As a bankruptcy lawyer, I see in our courts a lot a number of pro se parties. It's been my experience that when you've got one person in court, or sometimes more than one person in court, who's not represented by a lawyer, that it affects the process in the courtroom, it affects how I can practice as a lawyer, and it's an area that I find very perplexing and difficult to deal with, and it's an area that Judge Tai is particularly knowledgeable about.
Well, only knowledgeable because we have so many, we have no choice but become knowledgeable in my district. I think that on the communication theme we've been talking about, for the self-represented party, There's just no way around the fact that this dispute is deeply personal. There's no professional objectivity. And you might not have the lawyer posturing going on, but you got somebody who can't pay or hasn't been paid, who is very upset about it. So it's really important to get in there early and talk about the case clearly, directly, let them express whatever emotion or outrage and get that out of the way. But I find it's really important to get the legalese out of the proceeding as much as you can while still following the rules early on. It's tough where you have a represented party up against a self-represented party, and that's probably the situation most of the lawyers in this room deal with. I guess Professor Link can go into it in more detail, but you can't give that self-represented party legal advice. You've really got to be careful. As much as you want to say, well, you know, you might think that, but under the law, this, this, and this can't happen. You've got to be so careful when walking that line. So what I like to do in those situations, if it's a type case where there's a case on point and there's a case that lays out all the elements, or if I've written something on it before that lays, this happens a lot in the student loan non-dischargeability area because they never have representation because the opportunity to discharge is so limited, I'll hand a copy of the case or my previous ruling to both sides in court and say, this generally lays out the legal standards. Your case might be a little bit different, but I want you both to know what kind of law I'm going to apply here. And that somewhat evens the playing field, and I think it makes it easier for the represented party, for the lawyer, then to discuss the case with the self-represented party. So you see the judge gave us this. Let's talk about this and this when I sent him outside to talk, because you really have to educate the self-represented party on what the standards are. They might not realize they've got no case or they're out of their league.
It's supposed to require equal justice under the law. When you're representing a client as a lawyer, and you're held to be responsible for the rules, how do you explain to the client that the judge isn't holding the pro se litigant on the other side to the same set of rules?
And it's a huge problem because the lawyer has to follow the rules, but the other side can profess not to know, this deadline and that deadline. And I think you have to have an early status conference and say, this is what's going to happen. And this is the deadline. And do you need me to change that deadline and talk about the dates right up front? It comes up most commonly with motions for summary judgment, and they're case dispositive often. So it's a big problem. And the represented party spends all this time preparing the motion and, you know, all the attached undisputed facts. And it's a lot of work and very expensive, and then get no response whatsoever from the self-represented party. I'd like to see in advance, if that, you know, see that coming and say, look, when you've got the person in front of you, you've got to answer by this date. If you don't answer, a judgment can be entered against you. That means the case is over. You don't get a chance to tell me what happens in court. You have to explain it. I think if you don't give the self-represented party a real chance to respond, you're probably hurting your client as the lawyer because you've got a chance of reversal, that you really do have to make sure they understood and it was fair. And unfortunately, they run up costs for you because you're going to have the case continue to give them a chance to respond. So your best bet is to bring it up at a status conference, talk about it in advance. Do you need 2 weeks longer than the rules allow? Okay, we're going to set this deadline. And do your best to raise it beforehand if you think you're going to be bringing that motion. Anything you think you want the judge to educate the self-represented party about, raise it in the status conference so you can have that discussion and the rules of the road are clear in advance. It's a very difficult situation. It's a question back there.
My name's Ann Aiken, and I'm a district judge in Oregon, and I've just passed my 29th year on the bench. The issues that we're not talking about, and this is like a first world legal problem that we're discussing right now, is 80% of the population cannot afford a lawyer. We're only serving 20. And as a result of that, we're dealing with such minute issues that when we have people who really have disputes, we're not open for business. And I really admire the gentleman for raising the point. I've said this for years to defense lawyers. If you scorch earth the plaintiff bar, what do you think you're going to have for a job? We need to have these disputes resolved in a fair way. And this rule, when it came into effect, I was asked to speak on it. I said, I don't need to speak on it. If a judge manages his or her case as well, this rule is irrelevant. And if we get in and manage them and we treat lawyers as lawyers. So I don't have Rule 16 conferences. The lawyers know that I'm going to count on them to manage their case as well. And when they start to misbehave or file things that show that there's a problem, they are going to use, I'm going to use every trick in the book to bring them in, and they're going to come in and address those issues. But when I first came on the bench, we had this practice of, it was book report court. We did motions, summary judgment motions, and then immediately set the trial. So people didn't have a chance to do ADR. So I scratched all of that and set out a different routine, which is starting from the beginning, when do you want your settlement conference? Not if, when. Mm-hmm. And to start talking to them about exit strategies. But if we don't appreciate that there are 35,000 students graduating from law schools every year, and the Department of Labor says there are only 14,000 jobs, we have a bigger issue to talk about than worrying about what's happening for these lawyers who are getting hauled into court with cases where they really need the discovery, and they need the court to intervene and think through how to help them get what they need to try the case. What I've found is people are hiding a lot of data and making it so difficult and burdensome and financially difficult to put real issues in front of the court. We have an obligation to do something much better here because most of these disputes are so complex, so complex. I agree with Lynn. We see big environmental cases, big white-collar cases, big mortgage fraud cases, and we need to be able to have the time and the great lawyering to do good work and not cut them off at the knees with arbitrary rules across the board. So I think we need to think much bigger about all these issues than just what this first world problem solution may be, because it doesn't even begin to address the bigger issues, and that is access to justice in the courtroom, in the federal courts, with excellent lawyers on both sides, be it civil or criminal cases. And I'm very concerned about where these directions are going in both arenas. Now, I'm at the end of my career, so I'm going to lay this out there for the lawyers who want to have the opportunity to have the end of a great career.
Thank you, Judge.
Judge, that's a hugely important issue. The ABA has just completed a year-long review of the future of legal services and providing access to that 80%. And this also connects to the question about what happens when you have a pro se litigant before the court. Those 80% are not the clients are going to have the complex cases. The complex cases, the class actions, the environmental cases, the complex contractual disputes, they will all be well represented by counsel. And the 80% will have other cases, and if they meet the jurisdictional amount, they will get into, they are eligible for federal court. And the question is, do we want them to be unrepresented pro se clients or not? And I think most of us would say not. One of the comments I'd respond to you is one of the challenges the lawyer has who's representing the client against an unrepresented litigant. One of the first challenges, putting on my ethics hat for a minute, for Rule 4.3, you have to make sure you never let the unrepresented client think that you're disinterested. He or she has to be clear that you're representing the adverse party. But you may want to explore with the court, with the judge, whether or not this client or this claim is appropriate for appointed counsel, for appointment of counsel. And do they meet the tests for indigency? Do they meet whatever other tests the district has for appointing counsel? And that might be a way to address that issue. One of the issues being explored today by the bar is how to connect these many law graduates, people who've passed the bar, people who are qualified as lawyers, but who are underemployed, to make them available to pro se litigants. One, it gives the lawyer experience in handling a case, working with clients, going to court, and it gives the unrepresented client representation, and it gives the other lawyer some confidence that their client will not be held to a higher standard of knowledge about the rules, about the process, than the other side will. I would argue that even when the adverse party is unrepresented, the rules still apply, but there is a level of education the judge has to provide to that person so that they can understand what the rules are that will apply to them. But it's obviously the preferred option would be both parties are represented by competent counsel, and yet because we haven't achieved the goal of inexpensive representation, there are situations where counsel will be facing an unrepresented adversary, and one has to be clear how to address that, whether appointment of counsel would be appropriate. Do you really want a counsel appointed for the other side? And if not, to what extent the judge appropriately is educating the adverse party as to what the rules are, and to what extent do you think they're getting a free ride that is harmful to your client?
But Professor Link, there's another side of it. My client says, well, if that fool wants to come to court without a lawyer, or if they can't afford a lawyer, let's take advantage of it. By golly, you're a good lawyer. You know how to do this. Let's just go stomp on them. Why should I? I mean, I'm supposed to be a zealous advocate. If they don't have a lawyer, then that's their peril, right?
Well, sure. And in fact, a client may say that. As we talked before, 3.2, you still have the obligation to try to expedite litigation. You still have the obligation under Rule 26 and under pretrial conference rules, the status conference rules, to work with the other side. So you don't really have that freedom, that flexibility, that to stomp on the other side just because they're not represented by counsel. The requirements in the civil rules are not that lawyers must be nice to other lawyers. It's that parties must treat other parties with respect. And the parties are represented by counsel, so usually it's counsel to counsel, but this may be an example where that's not always the case.
I would add, you know, as lawyers, our obligation is not just to a client, and it's not just to a firm, it's to the court, and it's to the public. And we can't lose sight of that. And I think the last two of those obviously become very much in play when you're talking about a pro se litigant. I think we all have an obligation to make sure that the courts become, in fact, in Idaho, we have a swearing-in ceremony, a joint ceremony. And I love listening to the oath that the lawyers take every year about never denying someone justice because they don't have money. It's just a reminder every year of that obligation. And I think we have that. You know, Idaho, and I think virtually every district in the Ninth Circuit, has programs where attorneys are expected and asked to participate in pro bono, pro se litigation. The Ninth Circuit, I know, guarantees an oral argument where the attorneys agree to do that. We guarantee a summary judgment hearing instead of a decision on the papers for the same reason. Again, we're all in this together as judges and lawyers and members of the public, and our obligation is so much broader than just the interest of that one client. Now, the rules of ethics say that is a very primary, significant responsibility, but we can't lose sight of the broader obligations we have.
Can I bring up a couple of risk issues here that are very real with the pro se? The first, be very, very cautious about, if you will, the accidental client, the unintended attorney-client relationship. We do see these claims. They are real. We have losses, and they come out of all kinds of settings. But when I think about interacting with someone who is pro se, you were saying, you know, please don't give any legal advice, and you know, we really can't. But the reality is lawyers do at times. And when these claims come up, what we hear is, I had no intention to create an attorney-client relationship. There was no fee agreement. I didn't bill anything. And you're focusing on the wrong person. It's not about you. It's about the individual you are interacting with. And we're really going to start to look at it's reasonable person standard. Is it reasonable that the individual that is responding to you, you know, responding to the exchange as if he or she is receiving some legal advice from a lawyer about their legal issue, and you couple that with, is it reasonable, foreseeable that they will somehow act or rely on this? You've got a problem, a very real problem. Hear me clearly, we have paid losses for this, and this isn't just once in a blue moon stuff. The other issue becomes, getting back now, limited scope representation, and be very careful here. A lot of the states that have altered the rules in terms of 1.2 will talk about
You may limit your scope. They generally say you have an affirmative obligation to document in writing your limited scope, and lawyers, honestly, are a pretty good job, you know, do a good job with that. But this is one of these rare areas where ethics and malpractice kind of separate a little bit. What we see is lawyers start to say, well, okay, I'm going to help this pro se individual behind the scenes. I won't make an appearance, you know, I'll do this, and they'll write this document. You know, you've only retained me to do this and not the other stuff. Well, the problem becomes, what if they screw up the other stuff? They're not a lawyer, you are. Why didn't you, what's happening? We look at the rules and say, well, because I can limit my scope, surely I must be able to limit my advice. That's an assumption that may not be true. You know, it's going to be fact specific and these kinds of things. But I encourage you to think about, if you get into limited scope representation, I've seen some bankruptcy decisions along these lines. You know, you can sit here and limit your scope, but you need to make sure that the client understands the ramifications of what is coming if they screw something up. You know, what is the legal fallout to them? They need to be educated. So just a heads up with that.
Read our ethics opinion on limited scope representation. I don't have the number at the tip of my tongue, but it's available on the Ethics Committee website at the ABA.
The limited scope and the pro se parties kind of go back to what we were talking about at the beginning, though, is all the rules give the parties and the judges the ability to be case specific. We're talking about multi-million dollar lawsuits with multinational companies and the $10,000 dispute over who was paid or not paid. We have such a range of cases in the federal courts. The key is to look at what you have in that case, both of the judge and the lawyers. Don't assume because you have a pro se, a party, this is just, you know, a sympathetic person who can't afford counsel. I have a lot of professional pro se litigants who come in, and I look and they've had 30 or 40 different lawsuits, and there's no lawyer that would represent them because what they're trying to push is just ridiculous. And I have to ask enough questions and suss that out at the beginning of the case to realize, well, they're going to hold up that represented party and run up their costs. You've got to really look. These rules allow me to have status conferences periodically. If it's somebody on the other side who has nonstop money to delay and obfuscate, we can take care of that with having phased discovery, and then you can ask a lot of questions, and your requests for admission are going to be a lot better after you've had two phases of discovery and have enough information to actually really put a really intelligent request in. Or I can ask the pro se to come in and the lawyer to come in and bring all your documents, and let's sit down and walk through them. There's only 40 pages, and we can figure out what's relevant, not relevant, because it's really just about this one limited contract. You've got to be proportionate and case by case specific, and it is time consuming. The pro se party is very time consuming.
Right. One bit of practical advice, and I was in practice for many years before going into the academy. When you're dealing with a pro se litigant, if at the status conference, that should be where you have oral communication with the pro se litigant about whatever issues. Outside of the presence of the judge, you should write to them and do it in writing. Don't call them because they're not a colleague, they are not another lawyer, and your conversation can be turned into something quite different from what it was. So those communications should be in writing. The verbal communication should be preferably in the status conference before the judge at the court.
Let me add another element to that, though. One, there's no way we can get counsel for all of them. I have 26% of my litigants are pro se, and probably 20% of English is not their primary language, if their language at all. So communication is really tough, and there's no way around it. You need to enlist the help of the judge and do as much as possible in court at status conferences to protect yourself, the risk management that Mark talks about, and to kind of get it on the record what you've done and not done, because the communication is just not there for the vast majority of these cases. It's not possible.
I would echo that. It strikes me as well that, at least as an attorney, a written communication to a pro se litigant reminding them, or if not reminding them, making a notation that a deadline is looming and that if you don't file it or whatever step needs to be taken, I will take advantage of that because I have that obligation to my client and for judges to make sure that whatever it is that we submit to the pro se litigants, whether it's a Rule 16 plan, whatever it is, it should clearly spell out that there are consequences to missing deadlines so that the pro se litigant can't come back later and say, well, I didn't understand. Mm-hmm. And because I really believe that we cannot allow pro se litigants to drive up costs for other litigants. That would be inconsistent with Rule 1.
Yeah.
Thank you. Bill Newcomb from Seattle, Washington. It's been a very illuminating discussion. I wonder whether you experts agree that it might be useful for lawyers to recognize explicitly a sort of tension in our roles as representing folks in litigation. On the one hand, we have to be officers of the court. It's our job to be critical of the processes to make them work better for everybody. We are stewards of the system along with the judges, the judiciary. We have a major responsibility for a judicial process that works for everybody and to get that 80% into court when they ought to be. On the other hand, we're supposed to be zealous representatives of our clients. And there's at least a tension built into that, it seems to me, pre-trial in particular, as you're going through discovery and other kinds of narrowing motions. And sometimes just being clearer about the tension helps you understand where you, what sort of things you do in your role as a lawyer. I think the solution to the tension and avoiding it becoming a conflict, which it could become and does become, I think, in some cases, is communication. With all due respect for the problems of language barriers, which are huge in this part of the country in particular, I think the lawyer has to do a better job of communicating with a client and communicating with the judicial officer to make sure that the tension doesn't become a conflict and that the right decisions are made. And finally, just a note to follow up on bringing a client to court. When I was a Cub lawyer, I didn't particularly want my client to come to the motions calendar with me in Superior Court in Seattle because I was up against worthy counsel, some of them who knew the judges better, some of them who were just better at it than I was. But I do think that it's a better practice. There ought to be a very strong presumption of bringing your client to court for motions because the client is entitled to see you perform, frankly, and because I think the client needs to understand that courts are human institutions. They are quite imperfect, and trying to report, translate to a client what happened in court this morning in the motions calendar is pretty awkward and pretty, I think, unreliable. It's much better to have the client there, let her see what's going on, or let her see your advocacy or your lack of advocacy, let her see your opponent, let her see the judge, and you don't have to explain this as a completely nonsensical result. We should have won, or here's how we won, and it wasn't because of me, it was because of the judge or because of the opponent. But having that client there.
Thank you, Mr. Newcomb.
Is an important
I agree
way
with
of
you.
Doing things.
Can I have a point of personal privilege? Bill Newcomb is a past president of the American Bar Association, esteemed lawyer, and during his presidency, he led the association in redefining its goals and putting client representation and making us lawyers better advocates in the broad sense of trying to, as he pointed out in his comments, understand and fulfill our multiple roles. We all understand we are, and the preamble and the scope of the rules acknowledge we are representatives of clients. We can also be neutral mediators in proceedings. We also serve as roles as public citizens with a special interest in the law. People look to us to help expand and improve the scope of the law. And as Judge Windmill pointed out a few minutes ago, we are officers of the court. By the way, that point about being officers of the court, that's not true in every jurisdiction. In some jurisdictions, lawyers are admitted to the bar through their bar associations, and they appear before the court in every proceeding with the permission of the judge in that proceeding, that the permission is normally granted. It's not, but they are not considered officers of the court. as we are in this country. And so we do have these multiple roles, and we have multiple tensions. We want to be ethical lawyers. We also want to be successful. We also want to be prosperous and do well economically. And how do we sort of resolve that tension? I mean, we can't ignore it. We can't pretend it doesn't exist. That's part of why, you know, it's this profession does have a lot of stress to it, and it is hard. And I mean, the rules try to address it, both the civil rules, the ethics rules, and the whole system that we're engaged in. One of the most difficult rules for many young lawyers to grasp is 3.3A2, which says that a lawyer has an obligation to disclose to the tribunal legal authority adverse to the lawyer's client if that authority has not been disclosed by opposing counsel. And many young lawyers say, why in the world would I want to disclose a legal authority adverse to my client that the opposing counsel didn't disclose? Let the opposing party have a malpractice claim against their counsel. Why am I taking that away from the opposing party and hurting my client? And of course, the reason is because systemically, we want the judge to be as fully informed of the law as possible so that the decision rendered can be as just as possible. And we as lawyers have an interest in seeing that that systemic goal is met, is achieved. Does that create a tension with our role as zealous advocates? Yes, it does. I don't think we can avoid acknowledging that it does. But we have to acknowledge that it does and say that's one of the limitations the system imposes on our zealous advocacy. Rule 3.3 also says you can't suborn perjury. You can't put forward false testimony, even if it would benefit your client. Well, because we are working within a system, and due process requires that one of the elements to achieve a just result is that the process by which that result was achieved was fair, was truthful, was honest. And we are as invested in that process as the judges. Obviously, our role is different, but we are invested in that process as well, and we can't forget that.
There's a question back
there.
So
in the District of Arizona, I'm Steve Dichter from Arizona. In 2005, when I was on the Board of Governors of the Bar, with the advice and consent and a little bit of nudging by the Arizona Supreme Court, the word zealousness, anything with a Z-E-A in it, A-L, was eliminated.
I applaud you.
Completely. And that helped eliminate some of the tension,
yes,
and kick the bar lawyers into higher gear about going after some of this stuff. So that tension, it was deliberately sought to be reduced in Arizona by changing the lawyer's oath and the creed.
Ken Klee from Los Angeles. When I used to teach legal ethics, I pointed out the split in the state law between the duty attorney has as an officer of the court to violate a client confidence by calling to the court facts that would let the court know that the client was falsely testifying. In California, if you do this, you could be sued for malpractice. If you don't do it, you have to call it to the attention of the court. In New Jersey, if you do it, you are violating the New Jersey state law of ethics to zealously preserve client confidences. And in New York, it's ambiguous. And so you can set up a nice law professor's hypothetical where you have a New Jersey and an LA client doing a deal in New York, and then on the day of the closing, you find out that the collateral isn't there or something like this.
I'm taking notes.
And what do you do? And it is a terrible position for the lawyer to be in. The lawyer is the person caught in the middle between the court, who thinks the lawyer is an officer of the court, the client, who thinks the lawyer is the zealous advocate for the client, the lawyer's partners, who want the fees to be collected so the lawyer can get paid and bill enough hours during the year. It's the lawyer who's caught in the middle here. There are no easy answers to this. But the federal courts generally don't have a rule of federal ethics. Almost uniformly, the federal courts use the state ethical rules. And so when you have these multinational litigations, and even within our country, multi-state litigations, you can be exposed to conflicting ethical norms. And this just puts the lawyer in an impossible situation. So I would love it if the ABA rules was a national standard. The Justice Department, by the way, is a, is a, an advocate for having one uniform set of rules. When the U.S. attorneys have to go into all these different courts with different rules, it drives them crazy. But I think it's time to have a uniform set of rules, and I guess I would ask the panel what you're doing about this.
Hey, Mark?
Yeah.
As a point of privilege, I'm going to ask the panel a different question. We've been asked to make sure that we have some takeaways from every program that we do at this conference. And so in our remaining 6 or so minutes, I'd like to ask each of our panelists to offer just a couple of takeaways, because we started with Preamble 9. We ended with Professor Klee pointing out that we've got these conflicts both among states and every day in our own lives. And so I'm going to ask our panel to give us our takeaways. And I think we'll do it with Judge Windmill, then Judge Tai, then Professor Link, then Mr. Bassingthwaite.
Sorry, I was a little distracted. But I think Bill Newcomb's comment, I was struck by that idea of tension. I think that's why probably some of us became lawyers, is because law is kind of nuanced. It doesn't lend itself typically to real easy answers in many cases. And I think sometimes it's really helpful to think of things in terms of tensions that we have to play against. And I think the two identified as officers of the court, as our obligation to zealously or diligently advocate for a client, but also the two additional ones that I mentioned, that is a responsibility you have, frankly, to yourself as a human being and having to have a life, and also as a member of a profession that has a unique responsibility to society. I think all of those are at play. And I think that's probably what all of that is captured somewhat nicely, I think, in Rule 1, just, speedy, and inexpensive resolution of all disputes. And so I think if I were to offer a takeaway, it would be to embrace Rule 1, embrace your responsibility as attorneys, join with us as judges, because we've had that responsibility for some time, and understand that cooperation is probably the way we're going to achieve that. And you know, I understand that there may be lawyers who won't be cooperative. There may be judges who aren't on board as much with Rule 1. But that doesn't take away our responsibility to constantly promote that idea in our interaction at bar association meetings, interaction with judges, on individual client communications. All of that, I think, becomes very important. I don't know if that is what you mean by a takeaway. I don't have anything concrete. I think we put some of our materials, ideas, and I'll leave the materials we put for you to look at. But that would be, I guess, my takeaway from the overall tenor of the conference. And I think Bill's comment really provides almost a thesis statement of sorts, I think, of what we're trying to talk about here.
Yeah, I could just say what he said, but I think that what we've pointed out in this conversation is this is a phenomenally difficult situation, and you are going to be in these difficult situations. Ken's point is very good. We don't even have one rule across the country, but the bottom line comes down to communication, and if we can shift our head out of this fighting war model, that's going to resolve the vast majority of disputes. So many of our disputes get way too expensive, and if we could just learn to talk to each other, ask curious questions, make clear statements, and stop all the lawyer posturing we were trained to do in law school, that's going to solve a big group of cases. If you stop and look at the individualized case, think about what you really have. It may be a multinational litigation with lots of money, but it may be something tiny where you just need to ask the right question. Stop and think. Stop making one size fits all. Communicate with the other side. Communicate with the court. And get away from acting like you're in trial all the time and we're just at war with words. And we'll get a lot further.
Right. I would endorse and support and second everything that's been said before. I think what we have to keep in mind is that the tension between different roles lawyers have exists. We shouldn't pretend that they don't. But recognizing the tension is actually a benefit. It means we cannot blindly say, my only obligation is to be a zealous advocate or to be a diligent advocate. That is a very, very important, critical obligation we all have to our clients. That's why lawyers exist, to represent others in legal proceedings. But in doing so, we have to recognize we have obligations to the process, we have obligations to the system, and the rules of procedure, whether we're talking about the federal rules of civil procedure or other rules, rules of evidence, whether we're talking about other systemic rules, as well as the ethics rules, are intended to help us, not hinder us, in balancing the multiple roles we have. And they provide guidance to the lawyer, and the judicial code, an argument can be made, provides guidance to the judges as to how we should address and resolve those tensions so that the tension doesn't become a conflict of interest because it's been resolved before it gets to that point. They exist, and that's why there are lawyers. That's why we stand in the line of fire to address these issues on behalf of our clients, but also on behalf of the legal system.
If we ever get to a uniform set of rules, and I think that would be a great thing, and if I ever have any say in what those rules might look like, I would argue vigorously to take the word zealous out of the rules. That's just where I happen to come.
Zealous is not in the model rule.
Oh, that's true. But this tension is here. I want to talk about that just for a second. The tension is real. But are we not even running with an assumption that it is a cross we have to bear alone? I would question that. My takeaway would be thinking about Rule 1.4, communication, and you know, how do I enable and allow my client to meaningfully participate in their representation on their matter? And if there are tensions that, you know, this is why I need to disclose this information that the other side has missed. My client, if they understand the tension, if they understand why these things are here, I think it's part of managing the relationship. I think it can help deal with the tensions. It helps educate society in a very slow but steady way. So question assumptions would be one of my takeaways.
With that, I want to thank the panel, but I would like to give you all a moment. If we've got any more questions out in the audience, everybody's hungry for lunch. Thank you all so very much.